Hi there, welcome back to my channel, Scrap and Coffee. Yeah, we're going to start with our hinged folio. So this is going to be a craft along type of video where I'm really gonna go through every step of making this project. If you haven't seen the introduction video for this project yet, where I show you the complete project, or actually the uncompleted version of the project, and at least you get an idea of what we're making, I have a link on top. On top, I always want to point to the ceiling, but on top to that video, so you can see what it is that we're making. So I'm not going to show you again. I have my cutting guide downloaded, and what we are going to do in this video today is make the base for the folio. And it takes a few steps, so I think we won't be getting any further than the base in this video. So in the cutting guide, you will see the project that you are making. And then there's also a supply list. I try to provide a supply list, and maybe I'm forgetting some stuff. I'm sorry for that, but I try to at least give you an idea of the basic supplies that I'm using. And then you get to the cutting guide, and then it starts with the base. And that's what we are going to do today. So I'm going to use the cutting guide to cut the pieces, score the pieces, and then construct the base of the folio. So the project is, and I didn't say that in the previous video, I think I made a little note in the video, but it's 7.25 by 7.25, and the spine is, the large spine is about 1 3/8. So yes, let's get a paper trimmer and some cardstock in, right? Okay, I zoomed out a little bit so you can see a little bit more of my mess here and there. But I need to get this paper trimmer in view. So I use this paper trimmer from Fiskars. It's the, I don't remember what it's called, but I have this one, and I also have these smaller ones, but I really struggle with cutting my pieces straight with this one. So this one I only use to cut smaller strips, because that's a little bit hard with this one. I'm very happy with this paper trimmer. Not everybody is very positive about this paper trimmer. That's mainly because you miss your measurements between 5.5 and 6 inches, which indeed is can be difficult at times. So but I'm pretty happy with how it cuts, and at least my pieces are straight. And what I use for cardstock, I like to use 80 pound weight cardstock, and the brand that I'm using mostly is the Color Mates smooth finished cardstock, and I buy that at the paper mill store. I will try to put links down below in the description box if you want to have a look at it. I live in Canada, right, and this store is in the US, but I can buy there in really large amounts, and it's just that's cheaper for me to do that, and I know that I'm using a lot, so that's fine. I'm gonna use the black for this one. What I normally really love to use is a charcoal, but they don't sell it anymore. But here you can see the brand on here. So this is 80 pound, which is for the black. I made a little note because I know people are gonna want to know that the black one is pretty sturdy. It's 250 GSM. But the other 80 pound colors, at least most of them, what I know, but you can always see that on the website when you ask for more information on the paper, this is 216 GSM, which I really love to use for my albums. For a folio, this is really nice because it's just a little bit more sturdy. It's close to, it feels close to a 100 pound weight cardstock, which you can also use for this folio. I don't recommend using 110 pounds because you're gonna get in trouble with your spines. You could combine a 110 pounds with 65 pounds, but my tryout is made with the 65 pounds. It's like what a lot of people in Northern America like to, well, I say a lot of people in Northern America, but I just know that there are pretty, quite a lot of people that like to use the Recollection brand because it's just easy to get, right? We can buy that at the Michael stores. And they have 65 pound and 110 pounds. So sometimes that is what is available to you. So maybe then you want to mix it up a little bit and then use the 65 on the spines and the 110 on the cover, etc. But this is made with the 65. It works, as you can see, but it's a little bit more flimsy than what my actual folio will end up being. So a little side information on the cardstock. Other good options are, by the way, bezel cardstock, which is 80 pound, and or at least available in 80 pound. And what I also know is a very good brand is it called Artisan Paper? It's from Country Craft Creations. It's only sold by Country Craft Creations, and they are in the US. I never bought it because shipping is crazy towards Canada, but that has more of a linen texture. But I hear nothing but good things about that cardstock, so that is a very good option as well. Okay, let's start cutting. I'm going to start right here on the beginning with piece A, and it says cut 2 pieces to 7 1/4 by 7 1/4. So that's what we're gonna do. I need some more cardstock than just one sheet, right? Put some sheets next to me and let's start cutting 7 1/4 to 7 1/4. 2 pieces. So I'm gonna cut myself 2 pieces and then I'm gonna label them. So again, that's 7 1/4 and 7 1/4. And then These are my pieces A. Then pieces B are cut 2 pieces, 7 1/4 to 8 1/4. So I'm going to cut the 8 1/4 first. And sometimes this cardstock is not completely straight. It's not very far off, but I'm just looking for the right. Sometimes if I turn it in like 90 degrees, it's better. So that's 1 8 1/4 to 7 1/4. One more. Eight and a quarter. And 7 1/4. So these are pieces B. Then we go to the next step, that's the spine. Cut 1 piece, 7 1/4 by 4 7/8. Now I know that my scraps are not big enough for that, so 4 7/8 by 7 1/4. And then we also need a piece CC, which is a piece that makes the spine a little bit stronger, and that needs to be 7 1/4 by 1 1/4. So this piece, scrap piece, is 7 1/4, so I only have to cut it to 1 1/4. I'm going to measure that on this side, which for some reason is always a little bit hard for me to read. So that is CC. Then piece D. Cut 1 piece, 7 1/4 to 8 3/8. So that's again a large piece. 8 3/8 by 7 1/4. Piece D. And then we need another piece that is going to make that spine stronger as well. Oh, I write down piece DD, but this is D. And the reinforcement piece will be DD. So was that this piece that was 7 1/4? Yes. DD, 7 1/4 by 1/2 inch. So these type of things are really hard to cut in this paper trimmer, but I'm gonna try. So I use my ruler. I just measure from where it's gonna cut to the 1/2 inch on my ruler. Small piece, right? But I do label it because otherwise I'm gonna throw it away thinking that's a scrap piece. Then we need 7 1/4 by 6 7/8. And then I believe that this, where I cut the 4 7/8 from, is large enough to cut to 6 7/8. It's a little bit more than 7. So I can cut this to 7 1/4. By 6 7/8. And this will go in the trash can. So this is piece E. And then piece F, cut 2 pieces, 8 1/4 by 4 3/4. And then I think that the first 2 large pieces that we cut off, if you use 12 by 12, that is, are 4 3/4. Yes. And they are both the same, right? Yes. So I can cut that to 8 1/4 in length. So you can make this with your 8.5 by 11 papers. I think I've designed it in a way that you can use those papers as well, if I'm not mistaken. So 2 pieces F, which will form our pockets. Okay, so paper trimmer can... Oh no, we need to cut 3 pieces of Tyvek. So let me get the Tyvek. Okay, I have some scrap pieces here that are already cut and quite straight. So I'm using black Tyvek, which is very convenient because my project is made out of black cardstock, so that's quite the same. But I know it's hard to get. So if you only can get white Tyvek, which you can find at office supply stores, post office, they are envelopes most of the time, and sometimes you can buy them in sheets or in rolls, but it's not always easy to get your hands on. But you can make it black by using an alcohol-based marker, like a Sharpie. That's often what I use to color my white edges. Or you can color it with alcohol ink. You could also use that. Or you just leave it white, of course. And if you don't have Tyvek, you can also use packaging tape to really make it stronger. That's an option that you can do if you don't get your hands on Tyvek. Okay, so I already measured. This is 7 1/4, and I need 1 piece 7 1/4 by 2 5/8, and I need 2 pieces 7 1/4 by 1 7/8. So can I get those 2 pieces out of here? That should work. So let's try that. And when I cut Tyvek, I like to cut from the top to the bottom because I need to be a little bit more aggressive. And if it's a little bit larger than the 1 7/8, it's not a big deal, but... Okay, that's 1. And the last time I cut Tyvek, I really cut into my finger, so... I'm a little scared now. Okay, that's 2. So those are the 2 smaller pieces for the spines. Put that to the side, and then I need 1 piece that is 2 5/8. So I'm just gonna cut... Does it really matter? 2 5/8... 2 1/2, 2 5/8 by 7 1/4. And if it's not completely straight, well, it's not completely straight. So those are my 3 pieces of Tyvek. I'm going to put them to the side as well and get rid of my paper trimmer and my scraps. I'm not really throwing it away. I'm just putting it to the side somewhere where I can reach it, because maybe we can use this for other pieces or for backing some embellishments. So I don't throw it away until I'm completely done. Okay, zoomed in a little bit. Let's see. The lighting here can be a little bit difficult, so I'm trying. Okay, PC just fell out of here. So I've cut it. The last pieces that I cut are on top, so I'm going to turn it over. So I start at the beginning again and just start on the top of the list again. So for piece A, we don't have to do any scoring. They are going to stay like they are, and I'm going to put them to the side. Then we have 2 pieces of B. So it says align the 8 1/4 inch side along the top of your scoreboard. So that means that the side where it measures 8 1/4 is going to lie here by your measurements on the top of your scoreboard. And score at 1/2 inch and 7 3/4. So that's what I'm going to do. At 1/2 inch. And I always like to go over twice because this is pretty sturdy and it makes the folding a little bit more easy. And 7 3/4. And my cardstock, I don't know what it is, but it's bending a little bit, so I want to make it flat. Okay, for the other one, same thing, right? 8 1/4 on top, score 1/2 inch, and score at 7 3/4. So you could score at half an inch, turn it around and score at half an inch. But the reason that I do this, I score at half an inch and then score at the 7¾ inch mark. There's a little error in your paper. It can be, the paper can be not straight to start with, or sometimes we just cut it a little bit different. There are those little margins that I want to take out as best as I can. You're not able to take out everything, but by scoring here at a half inch and then to the 7¼, I know that the measurement in between my score lines, in this case, is exactly 7¼. So it might be that this space here is not exactly half an inch. So I take that marsh or that not being completely straight out as best as I can. So I like to make sure that I'm nicely bumped up against the top and then hopefully take that little error out there if it's in there. Okay, piece C. This is going to be a spine piece and we need to do quite some scoring. I'm going to remove my letter for now and place it back after I'm done scoring. I'm going to align the 4 7/8 inch on top. And then I'm going to score at, make sure that I'm looking at PC, at 1 inch. At 2 inches. At 2¼. At 2¾. 3¼. So all of this is in the cutting guide, right? 3¼. 3½. And 3 7/8 inch. Okay, so now make sure that I know that this is PC. And then we go to PCC, doesn't need anything. Piece D. Align the 8 3/8 inch side on top. Okay, we've done that. And score at 5¼. So again, I'm making sure that this is exactly 5¼ inch. I'm taking the error out on this side. I should be doing that even more often. I'm not always doing it, but I try to think about that. So 5¼, then 5 5/8 inch. So 5½, 5 5/8 inch. 5 7/8 inch. 6 3/8 inch. 6 7/8 inch, 7 1/8, and 7 3/8 inch. So I know these are some weird measurements, but trust me, there's a reason. It's gonna work out. Okay, piece D. Then again, piece D doesn't need anything. We've got the Tyvek. Okay, piece E. Align the 6 7/8 inch side along the top of your scoreboard. So this is not right. This is what we need to see. And score at 1 inch. And 1 5/8 inch. This one is a little easier. Yes, 1 5/8. So 1½, 1 5/8. Piece E. And then we end with two pieces F. Okay, align the 8¼ inch side on top, score at 1/2 inch, and at 7 3/4 inch. And then it says align the 4 3/4 inch side on top of your scoreboard and score at 1/2 inch. So here, what I like to score on my right hand side, I score at the 4¼ inch mark, which is also 1/2 inch. Let me change that in the cutting guide for you. So if you see your cutting guide, it would say score at 4¼. So those are the places where I normally say 1/2 inch, but it's actually better to score on that side because I can already see that this is, I think this is just over 1/2 inch actually. And the other one, same thing. 1/2 inch, 7 3/4. And then at 4¼. Okay, scoring is done. Let's start with or pieces A and B again. Of course, I know what we're going to do with this. So pieces A and B again. I'm just going to turn over my pile so it's in order again from the beginning. So with our pieces A, we didn't do anything. I'm just going to put them to the side again. And we are going to start with our pieces B. We need to apply tape. Now I have a basic rule where I say you apply your tape on the dented side of your score line. And what I mean with that is when you make your score line, you get one side where there is an indent in the paper. And when you turn it over, there is a side where it comes out of the paper. You can feel that score line coming out. That is the bumpy side. So basic rule is we apply our tape on the dented side unless I say otherwise. So if I'm not saying anything about where the tape is going, it's on the dented side. So for our pieces B, we are going to do that. I'm going to get my double-sided tape. I like to use 3/8-inch tape. That is definitely what I prefer for my album constructions. You can do this with wet glue or whatever it is that works for you, right? It's not the only way that works, but this is what I prefer. So I think I can put my cutting guide to the side because we are done cutting and scoring. Make some space. So when I apply my tape, I place that between the cut edge and that score line. And I stay a little bit closer to the cut edge than to the score line. And then I use this square thing. It's an OmniGrid ruler, which is used in quilting quite a lot. But it doesn't slip very, it slips, but it's not as slippery as other rulers, I think. But it's just a really handy thing to I just only use it for this, but it's easy, it lies in my hand nicely. I just enjoy using that. So we do the same thing for our other piece. I don't try to pull too hard on my tape, but I do want it to be straight, although it's pretty forgiving if you burnish it. I'm burnishing the tape after applying it because your tape gets a better stick and it makes peeling back your tape backing a little bit easier as well. So I'm not gonna taper my 1/2 inches now because it will make the placements of our spine pieces a little bit easier, I think, later on. So I'm not tapering this. I'm just going to fold, and when I fold, another basic rule is I fold towards the bumpy side of a score line. So I'm turning it over where I can see the bump, and then I fold on it. I fold with my fingers. I like to get a bone folder and burnish that fold to a nice crisp fold, and then the tape will end up being on the outside of your 1/2-inch flap. So we do the same thing with the other score line. Fold that. And I'm going to repeat that for this piece B. So one more time. Do it a little quicker now. You can always pause the video, right? If I'm going too fast and you really want to do this while I'm doing this, you can pause the video. So we're going to make two sets with each one piece A and one piece B. We are going to form binding pages with this. And the reason that I'm doing binding pages is because it's a little bit more sturdy. Your piece A, I'm just going to flip it around so the letter will be visible later on, is a square piece. So it doesn't matter how that lies in front of you. And we are going to align piece B on four sides. So I just like to remove the tape backing here a little bit, but you can do this however you like. I'm always a little bit slow with this step because I want it to be nice and nicely lined up as best as I can. And then I'm going to push it down here where the tape backing is removed. Place my hand on it. Don't push too hard. You want to make sure that you're still able to remove the tape backing. And burnish that down. And then do the other side. That's one. One binding page made. So these are things that often in album making you will find some sort of tunnel or binding page in there. And since we are working with a hinge in this folio, we need to make some more binding pages because this is actually going to be the cover, not a page. But also for that you can use a binding page. Okay, that's lined up. And then the other one. There we go. So now I don't know, did I burnish this one? I forget. So I just do it again. For a good stick. Mainly for a good stick. Okay, those are prepared. This was easy. Now we're going to go to PC. And we're just going to do this step by step. I try to explain to you as best as I can. So this piece has a lot of score lines, as you can see. But here, it's not really in the middle. It's a little offset. But you find 2 half-inch sections. And on both sides, on either half-inch on the outside, you see a quarter-inch section. We are going to keep our eyes on that. We are going to turn this over to the bumpy side. And I'm going to apply tape on one of those half-inch sections. I'm going to use 3/8-inch tape for this. And I need to find that half-inch section. My lighting is not the best lighting at the moment. And what... So this is there, and then I'm going to get quarter inch tape. I have different sizes of tape. If you don't have that, you're going to burnish this, peel off your tape backing, and then you're going to overlap your tapes a little bit, because I'm also placing tape on that quarter inch section next to that half inch. And I don't want to go over the outer score line of that quarter inch section. So if you're going over that score line in between those two, that's fine, but you don't want to go over that one. So if you need to overlap your tape, that's what you do. If you also have this combination, then you can do that. So just make sure that you don't go over that score line with your tape. So there we go. And I'm going to give that a burnish. So now what I will do is fold on the score line. I always lift it up, but then I forget that it's not focused. I'm going to fold on the score line in between those half-inch sections there. So we're going to fold, and I'm actually going to turn it over so I can see if I'm lined up on the sides and burnish. So now I will open that back up, and I'm going to remove both tape backings and close it again. And give that a burnish again for a good stick. So now I'm going to get this flap here and I'm going to pull back on it, and you will fold on the second score line from the folded edge that we've just created. So if you pull up on it, you will see that you actually automatically will fold on that one. Maybe you want to get some nails in, depending on the thickness of your cardstock, and burnish that fold as well. So when we turn it over now, we also have, it's lying flat here, right? So here also you see 2 score lines. You're going to fold on that second score line here from that folded edge. And then you create your actual hinge. So again, burnish that. Okay, let's apply tape on this hinge that we formed here. So you have that piece that's coming up. We are going to apply tape on there, and we have a half inch section, and then a score line, and then a quarter inch section. And we're going to make sure that our tape is going to stay above that score line. So let me do a piece and then I can show you. So again, I do this with 3/8-inch tape. I actually never use half inch tape. I have it, but from a cheaper brand. I hardly ever use it. So I'm going to apply this on that hinge. I'm staying really close to the folded edge and making sure that I'm not going over this score line here. And I'm going to do the same thing on this side of that hinge. Okay, come on. So I'm doing this in small sections so I can really guide where this tape is going, right? Okay, that's there. And let's right away taper this hinge as well. So we're going to taper. That means we're going to cut a little angle in that hinge. And we have that score line here that divides that half inch and that quarter inch. I'm going to put my scissors just above that score line. And I'm going to angle my scissors where I cut towards the folded edge of the hinge. Cut with an angle. And it's not really, it doesn't matter how sharp your angle is or not sharp. It doesn't have to be much. Just put your scissors just above the score line. Just make sure you don't cut in the score line. And just cut with an angle. And that's done. Okay, what I will now, our piece CC will come in play. This is going to reinforce the spine on the back side. When we fold it over to the bumpy side, we are going to apply this piece in between those two score lines that we can see there. And you don't want it to go over, so just give that a dry fit. If you need to cut it down a hair, then that's what you're going to do, because these score lines need to be able to function, right? So I'm thinking, am I going to fold on the score lines? Let me just do that. I'm going to fold and burnish it first to the bumpy side, and then I will also train it towards the other side. So let me do that again on the other side. I'm going to fold towards the bumpy side, burnish that, and train it to go to the other side. Okay. There we go. Now I'm going to apply tape on this piece. So I'm thinking, let's just use this 3/8 inch tape. Let's not use too much different tapes, but no promises that I won't do it on another piece. It's also just a little bit quicker. And I think this is going to be quite a long video already, because there's just a lot of steps in these pieces here. So I'm doing the edges. We will cover this up with the Tyvek later on, by the way. But I still wanted to have a good stick. Okay, and I'm going, probably my 3/8 inch tape will fit in between there, but I'm just gonna do a 1/4 inch strip. Okay. Filled up. Again, give it a good burnish. And I'm going to lie this as flat as I can, so I'm going to put that hinge flat. Maybe you want to burnish it a little bit more. And I'm just gonna... What am I gonna do? I'm gonna remove two pieces of tape backing. And just carefully, you want to have it from top to bottom and in between the score lines. So I'm going to stick it down here at the edge. And then carefully try to bring it to where I want it. So not everything has to be quick, right? And then somewhere I have tape backing, and I will tell you if this was smart or not. Oh, it's okay. It's okay. For a minute there, I was afraid it was going to be hard to remove the tape backing, but it was fine. Okay, now we need to apply a little bit more tape. More tape, yes. On these 1-inch flaps, we are going to apply tape as well. And we need to do that on both sides. So on top and bottom, on both the 1-inch flaps. So I will use again the 3/8 inch tape. And we're just going to place a strip here. And I will also do a strip above that. Just make sure you don't go over that score line, but if you place them close to together, you will have about an 1/8 of an inch space there. If you use the 3/8 inch tape, that is, of course. Okay. And one more piece above that. There we go. So I was actually thinking, I had this little silly idea, because my channel is called Scrap and Coffee, right? And I will try to tell you later where that comes from, if you are curious. But I was thinking maybe name my project a little bit more after coffees. And I was thinking for the craft along projects to call them cappuccino projects, because cappuccinos can be a little bit easier to digest or something. I know that felt just for the right type of coffee for it. It's actually my favorite type of coffee. And I also like myself a really good latte macchiato. I don't drink black coffee. It's too strong for me or something. I don't know. But I also have quite some small projects that I want to start sharing on YouTube. If you're in my Facebook group, you know them. And I was thinking about calling them Espresso Project. So, and then from there, let's see what else we can come up with, right? So I thought that was fun. So I'm thinking this is going to be like a playlist with cappuccino projects, which are actually craft along projects. Okay, all the tape is on here. What I'm gonna do now, just like we tapered this hinge, and my scissors are really sticky, I need to clean them. We are also going to taper these 1-inch flaps. So we're going to do the same thing. I'm going to put my scissors just above that score line, because you don't want to cut into that score line, and cut with an angle. And again, it doesn't have to be a very sharp angle. You just want to cut off a little piece. So I always start cutting at the score line, or actually just above it. So that means that my piece is going in several directions in order to do so. So I don't cut like this, because then you have a slight chance of cutting into that score line, and I don't want that, right? Okay, there we go. So now this spine is completely constructed, finally. And we are going to get our base pages back in that we've created some time ago. Feels like forever, but it's not that long. You are going to have the openings to the side. And it doesn't really matter now if your little binding spine here is like this or like this, because you can turn your piece around. It's all fine. What I'm going to do is I'm going to give it a dry fit, if it fits up to the score line. And it does. And now I'm going to take it out. And I'm going to remove the tape backing on this side, but only on the top. I will remove the other side here later, once it's in there. Because now I can glide it in here without sticking on the bottom, right? It's already difficult enough with having all that tape showing on one side. And once I'm happy with my placement, I'm going to stick it down. Turn it over and try to peel away. And this is a little bit of a stiff piece now, right? So it might be in your way a little bit. Peel away that tape backing here, and it's a double layer, so I start with the one that's the furthest away from me. My English sometimes it's terrible, sorry. And then like that. And burnish that again. So now we do the same thing on the other side. So if you prefer to do that again on this hand, you can just turn your project around, right? Okay, I need to taper this side a little bit better. So just making sure I'm not going into the score line, and try that again. Better, yes. So that's how you solve that, and that's why I give it a dry fit. So again, only on one side the tape removed, and you can try to push down on it a little bit so it doesn't stick on you before you want to. And slide it up to the score line, where you're still able to see that score line, right? You just don't cover that score line. And turn it around, and again try to get that other tape backing out of there. One. Two. And again, burnish that. Okay, so this is like a basic cover now. And I think I'm going to do the first piece of tie back right away. So this is where your large piece comes in, where this is 2 5/8 of an inch. What I'm gonna do is on one side, and let me see, the front side of your album will be where you have the largest, do I say that right? Or am I lying? So where you have the largest spacing, that's going to be the front of your cover. So if you want to make sure that that's what's going to look good, then that's where you're going to make your mark. But it doesn't really matter. You probably cover it up with pattern paper anyway. But for now, I need to have a guideline. So I'm going to make a mark 5/8 of an inch away from this edge of your piece A or B, whatever it is that's showing here. And or your score line. The same, it doesn't really matter. So 5/8 of an inch. And I'm just going to make a thin pencil line. And I don't go all the way to the top, not all the way to the bottom. But this is a little guideline for placing that Tyvek. I'm going to cover this Tyvek with double-sided tape again. And I like to give this a very good coverage. Like a complete coverage. I can do this one even. So I'm going to do a large roll. This is a 2-inch roll. Yeah, if you don't have that, you just fill it in with smaller size. But this, again, it's a little bit more quick for me. Okay, that's one. And I need to fill up this little piece here. So I think I will do 2 strips of 1/4 inch. That will be better than... So the edge is important. I'm going to go along the edge. And fill this in here. So I have a little bit of room, but it's really minimal. Okay. So I am going to get a Sharpie now. And I'm only going to worry about the short sides because I will do the long sides. I'm going to cover it up anyway. But I'm going to get my Sharpie and color the edge of the Tyvek where the white is showing. Because I don't want to see that white later on. And I'm not sure if I'm doing this right. I will see after it's on there. I need to do this better. Okay, so I have that little guideline there. So I have 2 small strips of tape here. I'm going to remove those. So not everything is sticking. Maybe this is not completely straight, but I hope it is. Try to make this as flat as you can, but it's going to fit on here from top to bottom, right? So I'm going to have my eyes on that. Let's start here in the corner. I use my pencil line as a guideline and I try to line it up with the top edge and then bring it. Ooh, close one. Bring it along that pencil line, which hopefully makes it to go straight. And now I will remove the other tape backing. I think I'm just, if you ever have ever seen me wrap a spine, no, this is not gonna work. I'm just gonna do it like this. I might have some overhang on one side and be a little short on the other side. That's what it is. Okay, let's see. Yes, I have some overhang here. You can see that pretty clear, so I'm going to cut it away. And I'm going to do it with my scissors because I think my knife is not gonna do this very neat. Oh, I'm just messing this up with these sticky scissors here. Try not to cut into your cardstock if you need to do this. Come on. Just one more little piece. Yes. And I'm going to recolor that edge. Oh, see, I ripped this a little bit. Never had that before. Let's see if I can glue that. Okay, some wet glue. Let's see how that dries. Okay, Sharpie. And color that edge. Try not to go over it more than needed, because it will change the color a little bit, but... Okay, so this is a little bit more stiff now because of the Tyvek, if you're using the Tyvek. So you might want to go in and really fold that one more time, burnish it a little bit. But the fact that it's stiff is a good thing, actually. It makes it strong. Okay, that's one part done. Now we need to make another spine with a hinge. Okay, for this one, we need our piece D. So again, a lot of score lines, but maybe you recognize it. There's again those 2 half-inch spaces next to each other and that 1/4 inch on the outside of that 1/2 inch. So again, turn it over to the bumpy side, get some tape, and we are going to fill in one of those 1/2 inch spaces. Doesn't really matter which one, just do one. And then we will also do the 1/4 inch space next to that 1/2 inch space. So again, I'm doing this with my 1/4 inch tape, and you can do this with, if you don't have that, you can also overlap your tape. Just make sure you don't go over that out of score line. See, I have to overlap it here a little bit as well. And burnish that. So again, I'm going to fold on that score line in between those 2 half-inches. Make sure that I'm lined up. Give that a good burnish, and then we can remove that tape backing. And I'm going to close it to stick that on top of each other. And I will pull on my flap here. So that will again be the second score line from that folded edge. And burnish that. Turn it over. And here, it's flat. Again, I'm going to pull back and then fold on that second score line from the folded edge. And give that a good burnish. And then, again, we've created our actual hinge. So I'm going to put tape on my hinge. So again, you're going to stay close to that folded edge. Stay above your score line. We are actually repeating what we just did, only this piece looks a little bit different. It's a larger piece. Do the same thing on the other side of the hinge. Okay, almost there. Oh, nice ripping your cardstock there. Burnish it. And we will taper that again. So again, I'm going to find my score line, but I've ripped it a little bit just above that score line. Cut towards that folded edge. And the same thing on the other side. There we go. Okay, so we have a 1-inch space here as well. And then a score line and then a 1/4-inch space. So we're going to fold on that score line. Again, first to the bumpy side. This is going to be our attachment piece. And then I will also trim to go to the other side. And I'm going to put tape on here, on both sides. So I'm going to place my 3/8-inch tape. And I'm going to place 2 strips of that on here, on this 1-inch part. And I will do the same thing on the other side. And make that flat. And then, so this is going a little bit quicker now because I don't have to go into complete detail over everything. I hope you don't mind. So we've done that. And okay, let's taper this first. So I'm going to taper that 1-inch part. My scissors going just above that score line. cut with an angle and do the same thing on the other side. And we need our piece DD. So this is going to reinforce our spine here. I'm going to, I think a 3/8-inch strip of tape will be, will suffice for this half-inch strip of paper. Ooh. Come on, you have to rip there. So here goes the same thing. You want to make it flat, and that's the easiest way is to put your hinge flat towards the longer piece. Place it on there, and I'm going to place this in between those score lines here, because that's the part that I want to reinforce. So I'm just making sure that that fits from top to bottom. And let's just remove this tape backing completely. Okay. Just carefully, just take your time. Line up the edge there. And bring it where it's in between your score lines. Okay, and I think, yes, I have a little bit of overhang, so let me again try to cut that away a little bit. I'm precise like that. I'm not able to help myself. That's just what I need to do. So now I have one more score line here on this side that I haven't folded on. So I'm going to do that as well. So again, first to the bumpy side, burnish it, and then train it to go to the other side. Okay. So getting our piece back in. And piece E, I believe, is for the left. Piece D, are we working on, is for the left side. Yes, so like I said before, where you have the larger gusset on this middle spine is going to be the front. So you want to have it like this, with a large gusset, small gusset. And then on the left-hand side is piece D going to be attached in the binding page. So again, give it a dry fit to make sure that it fits, and it does. So remove the tape backings and try to carefully slide it in there without sticking. If I would do this for myself, I would probably turn the project around, but I don't want to confuse anybody, so I'm not straight. Ah, and I'm stuck. Darn it. So hopefully I'm almost out of my undo, so I hope that I can... If I mess this up, okay, I wanted to say I have to make this all over again, and I don't want to do that. Okay, phew. Let it dry for a second. Okay, let's try this again. See, it happens, right? Everybody has issues. I'm just not happy how that slides in there, so... And these sort of things makes my scissors so sticky. This is what happens. I'm cutting all that bare tape. See, this is better. There we go. And then, of course, I have to remove my tape backing here. And burnish it so this is in place. So it goes like this, right? So then we have those two smaller pieces of Tyvek, 1 7/8. Those are going to reinforce our smaller spines. So I'm going to do the same thing here, where I am going to draw myself a guideline on one side. Again, 5/8 inch. From that cut edge of your, in my case, piece A, right? It's also possible that you see piece B there. So that's my guideline. And some tape on here. What just happened to all my tape? I'm using it. That's what's happening. Okay. Let's get this covered with tape. And this is... The tape is quite forgiving, but... Tyvek is not as sturdy as your cardstock, right? So it can be a little bit more tricky to really cover that Tyvek with your tape. I know I struggle with it a little bit more. Ugh, that's what I'm talking about. So try not to stick everything down. Okay, so I've already have some tape backing removed, so let's keep it that way. And I'm just going to try my best to align it from top to bottom and along the pencil line. Give that a burnish and then remove that other piece. Again, I see that I have some overhang here, so I'm going to try to cut that away. I'm just precise. I would not be able to sleep if I know that that overhang is there. But it's not easy to get my scissors in, so I'm going to try my straight blade. But I don't want to cut into my cardstock. Okay, that's better. Okay, that's good enough. And get rid of that white edge. That's one side, the other side. Okay, and then we need to refold the score lines because it's stiff again, right? Yes, there we go, and then this side, really fold that. Okay, we're almost there. I know this is going to be a little bit of a longer video, but then the base is completely constructed, so let's just do it in one video. Okay, piece E, that's going to form our final little... spine there, but there is no hinge in it, so it's nice and easy. We have two score lines with a 5/8 inch gusset, and let's start with applying tape. So we have that 1 inch part here again, and we are going to put our tape on there on both sides. So again, I'm just doing two strips of 3/8 inch tape for that. So the other side, the same thing. And one more. So the reason that I'm doing this with 1 inch is, again, it makes it a little bit more sturdy, just a little bit more to hold on to. Normally, or most often, I would go for 1/2 inch, right? But now I'm doing 1 inch. And again, before I fold, I'm going to taper that 1 inch, so again just above that score line, and cut with a small angle towards that cut edge there. And now I will fold and burnish on a score line. So again, you fold towards that bumpy side. Burnish that. And then the other one. And burnish that. And then we can place this in our album already. So that went a lot quicker. So we have one more binding pocket opening. That's where it goes. So let's give the dry fit one more time. Perfect. Remove that tape backing. And then this spine we will also reinforce with that Tyvek. Okay, up to the score line, still able to see your score line. Just line it up with that score line. And now I need to peel away. It's getting pretty long. So, like, how am I going to do this? We don't need to throw our stuff. Oh, wrong way. That's what I mean. Like that. And try to get that tape backing away there. Okay, so our final piece of Tyvek needs some tape. So you can also just have that taped up, so you have it ready when you attach it, right? So again, let's try to get this done. See, I always struggle with taping up the Tyvek. But like I said, it's all pretty forgiving, so it will work out in the end. So remove that tape backing. So my tape is overlapping here a little bit, but I think this is just the quickest way to get a good coverage. So this is a 1-inch tape, by the way. Okay, I'm going to place it like this. Hopefully I'm not going to stick it on anything, but with my luck, probably it will happen. And I'm going to make another guideline to get it straight. So again, 5/8 of an inch. I need to open this up. 5/8 of an inch. I'm not sure how well you can see those pencil lines, but I make them really thin and not go all the way to the top and the bottom. So let's repeat this step one more time. There and there. I have a little bit of a fold in the Tyvek there, but you can burnish it pretty flat actually, so don't worry about it too much. Wow, no overhang, good job. Practice makes perfect, I guess. So get rid of the white line. There we go. And refold on those score lines. Okay, so this is the base. I'm really thinking like, oh yeah, I said this is how it's gonna be. So we also have our pieces F. That's the final thing that we will be doing in the video. They are going to form pockets. They are perfectly good pockets to make an estate window in them, but I'm not gonna do it. The reason why, it's the perfect size for a photo. So you can place a nice photo on here or a full-size photo. So I'm not gonna do that. With a full-size photo, you have to put some pattern paper on top or on bottom or both. We are going to apply tape on the dented side, right? Basic rule. On the dented side, on the three sides, with a score line between the cut edge and the score line. And you don't have to go all the way to your cut edge. You can just go from the score line here up to the score line there. So I'm just going to put tape on both pieces and then I'm going to take further steps. Oh, come on. So this is a little bit boring to watch probably. That's why most of the time I don't have it in the videos. Because who wants to watch me tape up all these pieces? That's what I'm always thinking, right? It's just you want to see how you construct something and and that's it. But every now and then it's good to have a really step-by-step tutorial. And even though there are some things in here that might be beyond basic, I still think if you really follow the steps, you can do this. Even with the acetate windows, I think you can do it. I hope that my explanation is good enough for people that have never done this before to be able to do it. So we have score lines here and here. They make a little intersection. We are going to cut straight through that intersection in about a 45 degree angle. I'm just going to make that cut. And I'm going to do the same thing on the other side where you have that intersection. So I know that there are people that do this. They cut and then they change the angle of the scissors, right? To make sure that you don't have any overlapping of your half inch flaps. Absolutely true. That works. You won't have any overlapping of your flaps. So why don't I do it? That's a personal preference. I kind of feel that when I do that, my corner is not as clean. And that maybe has something to do with the way that I cut. That's perfectly possible. I don't know. But I feel that there's a difference. And the difference for me is huge enough to do it like this. But I have to make sure that when I fold, that my half inches don't overlap. However, I do this so often that it doesn't happen to me very often that they do overlap. I just know how to cut and it doesn't say that it never happens. It happens. And then I just fold it back open and recut it. But yeah, I just prefer this. I have a really nice, sharp, clean corner now. I'm not saying again that that's 100% of the time the case, but most of the times, yes. And when I do the little angle, it's the corner is a little bit, yeah, I don't know, not nice and sharp. So I even feel it when I burnish if they overlap or not. So that's it. So here's it's just so minimal, you don't even see it. But here, this corner is not 100% perfect. So it happens, of course, but yeah, I just prefer to do it like this. So where are these pockets going to be placed? On our little flaps here. So I'm going to open one side. And actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn the piece and place it up against my chest. Get one of my pieces F in. And I'm going to align the bottom with the score line here. So you're going to leave that little gusset here free from any attachment, right? So I'm just going to place it up against that score line without going over it. So I am going to remove this tape backing on the long side on the bottom. I'm going to push this flat with my hands and then place the corner here where I want it. So just above that score line. You don't really have to keep any space because we have that gusset there. Bring it along that score line. Burnish that down. And then a little tip what you can do is get some tapes, just normal tape. And just place it. I did this in my pop-up album as well, right? Where you just, because I don't place my pattern paper over this whole piece. I'm just going to measure where I'm going about half an inch into the pocket with my pattern paper. But then sometimes when you want to put something in there, you bump up against this strip. And this is a little trick to make that a little bit less of a problem. So just place that over there. I'm removing this tape backing. And I'm going to bring it along the sides. So just do this. And then go there. But then I can close this and turn it around, open up the other flap, and repeat the same thing with the other pocket. So remove the tape backing on the long side. I'm going to push this flap, bring that corner, stick it where I want it, and then bring it along that score line. Burnish that and cover it with some tape. So what I often do, but you don't see that because I don't always film my decorating, but I don't always do it, but because I just don't feel like it, it's not always easy, but place some printer paper to go over here and then my pattern paper just a little bit into the pocket to prevent it, but I don't always do it simply because I'm too lazy. And then afterwards you always regret it when you're struggling with your photos in the album or folio. Okay, in place. So the base now is constructed, and in the next video we are going to work, I think it's on the left side, right? Page one on the left side. So we are going to work on the page for this little hinge here, and then maybe if we have time also on the back cover. So then we will end up with, I think, 3 construction videos before we start decorating. So this is it for this video. I know it's a long one, but yeah, you can always watch it in parts, right? If it's too long for you, or speed up the video. But this is it for now. So I hope to see you in the next one where we continue constructing this. Thank you for watching. Bye bye.